great anticipation. And while Advent is a time of anticipating seeing God in the midst of the struggle of this present world, this time last year, we were experiencing a lot of struggle. The COVID-19 pandemic was continuing unabated, beyond anyone's expectations, and it was precipitating the second shutdown of in-person worship here at God's Love. There was much uncertainty about our 2020 Christmas celebrations, both our personal at-home celebrations and together as a congregation. Political rancor was casting a long shadow over our communities, both in person and online, far longer after the presidential election. Tasked to write a sermon, I sat wondering, where is the hope in this? The nature of hope is a curious thing. Mark wrestles with the curious nature of hope in the midst of the extraordinary pain of his time. As Jesus and the disciples exit the temple of Jerusalem, the disciples turn back and gaze admiringly at the temple's beauty, marveling at its bright and shiny human architectural achievement. To which Jesus responds, "Not one stone will be left here upon another. It will all be demolished." And indeed, it was. Crushing the Jewish revolt in 70 AD, some 40 years following Jesus' death and resurrection, Roman authorities destroyed the temple, leaving nothing but a smoking pile of stones in disarray. This collective trauma scattered the Jews, thrusting them out into diaspora and into isolation. And in the midst of the warring unfolding around him, Mark is tasked to write a message of hope. Yet he begins this coded message with a warning. Jesus says, "Beware that no one will lead you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray." Jesus knows his disciples, the very ones who were just drawn to the false grandeur of the temple's exterior. He knows they will be tempted in the midst of the hopelessness of its destruction, and the false prophets, idols, and messiahs that hopelessness brings. The nature of hope in the midst of despair is a curious thing. For as Desmond Tutu once said, hope is being able to see the light despite all of the darkness. Yet seeing light in darkness, hope in the seemingly hopeless, is not easy. Perhaps like me this time last year, you also sat wondering, where was our hope? As we face the potentially long and isolating winter of 2021, and as everything closed down around us, forcing us out of this church building and into diaspora. When faced with life's challenges, it is easy to get distracted by false idols and messiahs promising relief from our discomfort. Mental health professionals will often talk about riding the wave of anxiety, feeling the feels, and trusting that relief will be on the other side of the peak of those anxieties and fears. However, false idols offer much temptation to opt out of those waves of difficult emotions. Drugs and alcohol offer false promises of relief, pathway for coping, and escape when we experience something painful. Not surprisingly, last year, cigarette sales in the U.S. went up for the first time in over 20 years. Our cultural landscape is rife with false idols and messianic leaders offering us either distraction from the present conflict or promising quick cure-alls to our ills. However, usually in exchange for our dollars or the power that we bestow on them with our votes. Social scientists readily acknowledge that the ongoing pandemic has been a source of collective trauma, and we continue to face the uncertainty of how this pandemic will ultimately shape our national and global economies and our society long term. Whether or not it's an experience of trauma in the form of a personal health crisis, or the death of a loved one, or the collective trauma of pandemic or war, we are all tempted to be led astray in our pain, failing to trust that all that we see and experience is not all that is or is yet to be. Perhaps it is because, as pioneer Helen Keller suggests, the curious nature of hope is that it sees the invisible, feels the intangible, and achieves the impossible. Mark begins his message of hope with a warning from Jesus to take heed of these temptations, to not be led astray. For war, disease, natural disasters, famine, and conflict are inevitable, inescapable experiences of this human realm. And yet these very real experiences of pain are not all that is or is yet to be. As I sat at my desk this time last year wondering, where is the hope in this? In the silence that followed, the obvious answer presented itself. Jesus. It's always Jesus. For our God is a God who entered into this human experience in the form of a child, born of real human birth pangs, emerging from the darkness of the womb to be the light in the womb-like darkness of our human circumstances. Jesus is the hope we receive by faith through Christ's faith on the cross. Theologian N.T. Wright writes that Jesus doesn't give an explanation for the pain and sorrow of the world. He comes to where the pain is most acute and takes it upon himself. Jesus doesn't explain why there is suffering, illness, and death in the world. He brings healing and hope. He doesn't allow the problem of evil to be the subject of a seminar. He allows evil to do its worst to it. He exhausts it, drains it, and emerges with new life. Jesus rides the wave, trusting that resurrection will be on the other side. And it is that faith of Jesus Christ which makes hope possible, achieving resurrection's impossibility. Jesus is the embodiment of hope in the hopelessness, yet in our pain, we humans need something to hold on to, something to steady ourselves in our disorientation. We crave the tangible, which is why in Mark's gospel, after predicting the forthcoming desolation and persecution, Jesus institutes the visible, tangible elements of our Holy Communion, the fruit and the grain that we might grasp the ephemeral nature of hope that he embodied, and also embody hope's possibility in our lives. It is this hope that the first century disciples clung to in faith, which guided them through their pain of living in diaspora, spawning a Jesus movement that has spanned over 2,000 years. This movement has created communities around the globe, like Lutheran Church of God's Love, which makes visible and tangible the hope found in Jesus Christ through its ministries. Ministries like Caring for Friends, the 2022 CAN Project, and the Good Neighbor Garden. Christ in us nurtures hope and comfort for those experiencing pain and loss here at God's Love by hosting AA meetings, Bible studies, and through our TLC ministries. This morning, we lift up the hope found in Jesus Christ through these knit and crochet gifts that we will bless today, and through your own financial pledges and time and talent sheets that we will receive and consecrate to God's work in our world. However, Thomas Merton reminds us that ultimately, the real hope is not in something we think we can do, but in God, who is making something good out of it. In ways that we still cannot see. Therefore, as we look ahead with wonder and curiosity to the next 50 plus years of ministry, we in the divine love of Jesus Christ, who through the pain of this world births resurrection again and again. Despite the illnesses of this world, its rumors of famine, disease, and war, we are not alarmed. We resist temptation to be led astray, for all of